So till now, we have started off with op amps, and you have already learnt the basics of op amps, the different parameters used in op amps, along with the working of non-inverting and inverting amplifier. Op amp working as a non-inverting amplifier and inverting amplifier, and you have also derived the expressions for the voltage gain, input impedance, and output impedance of all both these, in the sense inverting and non-inverting amplifier. You have derived everything. Okay, so I'm just next topic under this is DC amplifiers and AC amplifiers, in the sense how op amp can be used as a direct coupled amplifier or an amplifier for DC signals. So if you apply DC input signals and the op amp circuit amplifies it, is known as a DC amplifier. And whenever you give AC input signals and it will amplify, it is called as an AC amplifier. So a simple example of DC amplifier is, we have written actually the same circuits, the inverting amplifier, the non-inverting amplifier, and a difference amplifier. Three circuits we have shown here. I'll show the each one separately. So you can see here, in this first one, A, whatever is written as A, the inverting configuration, here the input V in is given to the inverting terminal of the op amp, and there is a feedback resistance RF, a load resistance RL, and at terminal 3, usually till now what you would learn terminal 3 would be grounded, right? For inverting operation, you would always see the non-inverting terminal, which is pin 3, would usually be grounded. But here, what we have done, this is how it is practically used, in the sense you will connect a resistor which will equal to the total resistance as seen between inverting terminal and ground. So usually in any op amp based circuit, please note down this and remember, the resistance, the Thevenin's resistance seen from inverting terminal to ground should be same as the Thevenin's resistance seen from non-inverting terminal to ground. So it's not that you connect only resistances in the inverting terminal and simply leave the non-inverting terminal to be grounded without any resistor. Usually we don't do that. The simple reason why this is done is to make any error voltage at the output, or offset voltages we call it as. You remember the output offset voltage. So in spite of both the input signals not being applied and both input terminals are grounded, there will be a small voltage at the output. That is known as output offset voltage, and that represents an error in op amps. So in op amps, this offset voltage is a representation of error, and that error can be avoided if I equalize the resistance seen from the inverting terminal to ground and non-inverting terminal to ground. So whatever resistance you see from inverting terminal to ground, if you can place the same amount of resistance between non-inverting terminal to ground, then you're removing the offset voltage or error voltage at the output of the op amp. Okay, so I hope you understood what is that. If you have any doubts, please ask. At any point of time, any doubts you can always ask. Okay, so usually in every practical op amp circuit, we try to include a resistance at the unused terminal, or in this case, this is the first case, this is an inverting amplifier, as you can see. and the input signal Vin is given at the inverting terminal through a resistance R1, and feedback is applied from pin 2 to pin 6, and that resistance value is RF. Okay, and instead of grounding this non-inverting terminal, we have connected a resistance R1 parallel RF. Why this value? So you can see, if I try to measure the Thevenin's resistance from this terminal 2 to ground, remember, whenever we use Thevenin's theorem, voltage sources act like short circuits. Yes or no? So when voltage sources act like short circuits, what happens? Here, from terminal 2, I have resistance R1, which is grounded. And so this is R1. And why R1 is grounded? Because this acts like a short circuit. We replace this voltage source with a short circuit. And similarly, from this pin 2 only, what is the other resistance which is connected? RF. So, and what is the other end of RF connected to? The output voltage V0. So, you remember, voltages, wherever there are voltages, you should replace them with short circuits or with grounds. So this end is also grounded. So what do you see connected to 2? You see this RF is connected with the other end grounded. So in effect, what do you see from pin 2 to ground? From 2 to ground, I have one resistance R1 on the input side, and from 2 to ground, I have a resistance RF on the output side. So ideally, whether I write this RF like this or whether I write it like this, it's one and the same. Okay. So you have two resistors, R1 and RF, connected from terminal 2 or the inverting terminal to ground. So what is the Thevenin's resistance seen from terminal 2 to ground? It is R1 in parallel with RF. If you want the effective resistance from 2 to ground, it will simply be the parallel combination of R1 with RF. Okay, so are you following this? So simply, whenever we try to build any op-amp based circuit, we will always try to equalize the resistances seen between the inverting terminal and ground and non-inverting terminal and ground. So in an inverting amplifier, initially you have a resistance R1 connected with the input signal in series with the input signal, and resistance RF connected as the feedback resistor for providing gain. Now, if I consider the Thevenin's equivalent resistance from pin 2 to ground, it will simply be found by making the voltages zero. Make V in 0 and V0 0. So in effect, you will have from 2 to ground R1 and same from 2 to ground RF, both in parallel. So what I'll do, since I know what is the resistance seen from pin 2 to ground, you connect the same amount of resistance from pin 3 to ground. And why do we do it? I told you to remember, the main usefulness of making this resistance connection is to make error voltages at the output, output offset voltage zero. If there is same resistance seen from non-inverting terminal to ground and inverting terminal to ground, then the error voltage at the output will become minimum or very small. And to do that, usually we make this resistor connection. Okay. So I hope now you understood why R1 parallel RF is connected. And the last thing is, between terminals 1 and 5, you know, in an op-amp, you have an 8-pin, it's an 8-pin IC. And terminal 1 and terminal 5 are called offset null pins. So how do we use that? We connect a 10K pot. You have any doubts? Why pin 4 is connected? Yeah. Why this? It's not, I'll just tell you here. That's what I'm telling. So between 1 and 5, you connect this 10K pot, and this pin 4 which we have connected to minus VEE, that same connection you bring it to the what? The controllable terminal of the pot. Remember, a pot is circular. It has three terminals, 1, 2, 3. Between end to end, between this end and this end, if you connect the pot, you will have a fixed resistance. That fixed resistance, say for example, it is a 10K pot I am using, just like this. So I will get a fixed resistance of 10K if I connect it from one end to the other end. But if I use this in between terminal, if I connect this in between terminal to something else, say I connect it to minus VEE as shown here. I'm connecting this pin 4 to minus VEE and also to the central terminal of this pot, then I will be able to get a variable adjustable resistance. I'll be able to get a variable resistance between these two terminals and these two terminals. So if I get 6K resistance here, I can get 4K resistance here. So I'll be able to control the amount of resistance, and hence I'll be giving some voltages to the circuit across this. Remember, we are using minus VEE also. So there will be some voltage across this and a different voltage. And when we adjust that middle terminal slowly, you can do it till the output offset voltage or the output becomes zero. And please remember, whenever you are doing this, there should be nothing connected to the input of the op amp. So even this terminal should be grounded and the non-inverting terminal should also be grounded. So without connecting any input signal, grounding both the input terminals, the resistors can be connected. That's not a problem, since we have already neutralized for this resistance R1 and RF. We have connected R1 parallel RF. But doing all this and connect this 10K pot between terminals 1 and 5 and pin 7 to plus VCC and pin 4 to minus VEE, and the same minus VEE pin 4 terminal is brought to the central terminal of the pot. If we do that, we are able to control the resistance, which will not be a fixed value now. So I'll get different values in the two places, and with that different voltages are applied to the op amp, which helps us in making output voltage zero. So remember, ideally we say if no input is given to an op amp, or if both the input terminals of an op amp are grounded, the output should be zero. But in any practical op amp, it won't be so. I will have something, say I'll have 10 millivolts output, even if both the input terminals are grounded without any input signal. Make all the other connections and ground both the input terminals, but still you will have a small output voltage. That is known as output offset or output error voltage. Okay. And to nullify that error voltage, there are many methods. One of those methods is to connect a 10K pot between terminals 1 and 5, which are called as offset null pins. In 741 op amp, they have provided these two pins just to nullify the offset. Okay. And by connecting the middle terminal and varying that terminal slowly, varying the pot slowly, you'll be able to bring it from 10 millivolts to zero. It can be either plus 10 millivolts, minus 10, it can be anything. There will be some error voltage surely. So to make that voltage to zero, to remove the error in op amp, we have to use these offset null pins and connect a pot. And the other way of doing, or along with this, an additional way, if we don't do this offset null adjustment, there are other ways of doing it. But one more added benefit is by making the Thevenin's resistance between terminal 2 to ground same as Thevenin's resistance between pin 3 and ground. Okay. So this is about what is each connection in this circuit. Here we are just showing a practical circuit. That's what I'm telling. the resistance connection here. You have already connected a resistance R1 parallel RF at pin 3, but that won't ensure that the output offset voltage is made zero. It can minimize the output offset voltage or it can reduce it, but it will not ensure that it is made zero. See, for our laboratory purposes, when we do experiments, all this we don't do because we are not working in minute levels. Okay, we are not bothered about micro or millivolt changes in the output voltage. If the output is, let's say, 10.001 volt instead of 10 volt, it won't make any difference for us in a normal lab operation. But only when you're doing high precision circuits, you want high accuracy. Say you're using it in satellites, you're using it in some other places, military applications, where very high accuracy is needed. Accuracy in the range of milli or micro volts is needed. Then we will worry about all this offset null things. So this connecting 10K pot and all that we'll do additionally when we want to make the error at the output completely zero. Okay. So there are other methods to make it zero, but I'll show you in the next diagram. In the next slide, I'll show you there are some more ways of making it. Here you have studied. First is this offset null method. The second one is to add a resistor here where we can't assure that it will be zero, but you can minimize it. By adding this resistor, it will not completely become zero, but it will minimize that error voltage. Please remember that. Okay. So for now, we will just, all you want to remember is you just have to see here. You have given a DC input. Vin is a DC signal here. So the output V0 will also be a DC voltage. Say, for example, I'll give a DC voltage of 0.5 volts and you have chosen resistors of value 1K and 10K, for example. So what is the gain of this inverting amplifier? Yes. What would be the gain of the inverting amplifier? It is minus RF by R1, right? So minus RF by R1 represents the gain of the inverting amplifier, which is 10. In this case, the gain becomes 10. And what would be the output voltage then? How much would be the output voltage? It would be 10 into 0.5, which will become how much? 5 volts. And this 5 volts at the output will be with a negative sign. So if I want to represent this like a waveform, how would you represent a DC? Say this is V in or VI. I've given a DC voltage of plus 0.5 volts. So I represent DC with a straight line, correct? And I'll be getting an output voltage. Say if this is V naught, I'll get an output voltage of how much? Minus 5 volts. So how do we represent that? Below the ground line. This is your ground line or the zero line. You measure the corresponding value and below ground line, you'll draw a straight line indicating the output is minus 5. This is how it responds to DC inputs. Remember, op amp is a very versatile device and it is mainly useful because it can be used to amplify DC as well as AC signals. Whereas in other circuits, other transistor based circuits, we can't amplify DC as well as AC. So either one of them you could amplify. Okay. So in this simple, all you have to remember with this simple circuit, I just explained to you why all these additional connections are seen. So what is the purpose of pin 1 and 5, why it should be used, and what is the purpose of connecting an additional resistance in terminal 3. So this is a complete practical circuit for high precision which will be used, but this is again working like a simple inverting amplifier. Give an input signal, its amplified version will be present at the output, and it's working like a DC amplifier because we are giving a DC input signal. Okay, so yes, it is simple. It is a simple DC op amp or simple inverting amplifier with better precision. Exactly, you're right, Aditya. So this is nothing, it's a simple inverting amplifier. I told the same thing in the beginning. I don't know if you were there. So even if you just ground this terminal, if you don't show this connection between 1 and 5, just draw the normal inverting amplifier and say that given a DC input, it gives you a DC output amplified by the level RF by R1. It is fine. Okay. So this is inverting. In the same case, in a similar way, we have shown the non-inverting amplifier in the second circuit B. You can see this is a non-inverting amplifier. Again, we connect the input signal to the non-inverting terminal, that is pin 3, and the inverting terminal 2 is connected to a resistance R1 which is grounded, and another resistance RF which is in the feedback path. So this is our simple non-inverting circuit, and we have written this circuit. Again, if I don't write this resistance and this connection, it is still fine. It's the normal non-inverting amplifier which you have studied. What happens in a non-inverting amplifier? Again, here, say you give a 1 volt DC input. We are talking of DC inputs. And say R1 is 1K and RF is, let me say, 3.3K, for example. What's the value of output voltage? Tell me, what would be the value of V0? RF is 3.3, R1 is 1K. So what is the gain in a non-inverting amplifier? 1 plus RF by R1. So RF by R1 is 3.3 by 1, 3.3 plus 1. So output would be 4.3 volts, correct? So output would be 4.3 volts. And this output voltage is visible at just like before. If you try to plot it, so if VI is 1 volt, this is VI. If VI is 1 volt, VO will be 4.3 volts and it will be on the same side, positive, because it is non-inverting configuration. So what are these additional things which we have added? Just like before, you just need to remember for now. So just like before, the additional things what we have added, one is this connection between pins 1 and 5, which is used for offset adjustment. Offset null pins, we connect a 10K pot and terminal 4. So that is just for, what do you say, minimizing the error or making the offset at the output 0. And another useful way of doing is, so we use both together, it will give us better results, is to connect another resistance whose Thevenin's equivalent value will be same as the resistance seen from pin 2 to ground. So again, here if you see from pin 2 to ground, you have R1 connected to ground from 2, and again RF from 2 to V0. V0 would be grounded whenever I use Thevenin's theorem. So R1 parallel RF would be the effective resistance seen from pin 2 to ground. The same value is included where between the input signal and pin 3. So what would be the effective resistance seen from pin 3 to ground? The effective resistance would be by shorting this voltage. Remember, Thevenin's resistance is always found by shorting voltage sources. The effective resistance from pin 3 to ground is R1 parallel RF, which is same as the effective resistance from pin 2 to ground. Anyway, I told you all these are just for better precision or reduced error. Okay. So the same thing is shown in a what? Difference amplifier circuit. We'll not worry much about this. I don't know whether you have recalled, you have done it in your basic electronics, I think, the difference amplifier. Let's not go into details. So in the difference amplifier or subtractor circuit, the inputs are given to both the terminals. So here you can see Vx and Vy. Vx is the input given to the inverting terminal, Vy to the non-inverting terminal. R1 and RF are connected in this place from Vx to pin 2 and from pin 2 to output. And the same values, R1 and RF, will be connected at the non-inverting terminal also. So though they are calling these resistors as R2 and R3, the value of R2 should be equal to R1 and R3 should be equal to RF. In that case, it works like a simple subtractor. Okay. So the output now will be minus RF by R1 into Vy minus Vx. Okay. Or minus RF by R1 into Vx minus Vy. Since I have taken this minus sign outside, if you remove the minus sign, it would be RF by R1 into Vy minus Vx. Voltage at positive terminal minus voltage at negative terminal. Okay. So if you use minus outside, it will take the voltage at inverting first. Minus. Yes. You have any doubts? Okay, so this is how. It's a simple difference amplifier. For now, we can leave out this difference amplifier and just consider an inverting, non-inverting. Here we have shown this as an example in the text. It's nothing. Any op-amp based amplifier can work with DC input signals. It will give you the corresponding output with DC input signals as any normal amplifier. So I want all of you to send your USN numbers to the chat, and you can do it within this 5 minutes. Anything outside this we'll not consider. Yeah. Vineet, tell me.
Mama,
you raised your hand, right?
Hello.
It was by mistake, ma'am.
Okay, okay. Okay, then.
Ma'am, let them enter USA. Let them mention their section also.
Yeah, when you send your USN, please mention your sections also.
From USN underscore section.
Just send it to your USN number and the section. Okay. Okay. So, in effect, what I want to tell you, an op-amp is a circuit. Any circuit application designed using an op-amp can work with DC as well as AC signals. We have shown the example of an inverting, non-inverting, and a difference amplifier, which can amplify DC signals. Okay. Same thing. I can skip this circuit. Somebody was asking then, what is the other way of nullifying the offset? You see this in this circuit. This is another additional method. Let me not go into complete details. Very briefly, I'll tell you, because this is not needed in the scope of your syllabus. Here, rather than simply connecting R1 and RF in, R1 parallel RF at the other terminal, we'll use a combination of three resistors and the voltages plus VCC and minus VCC. And using this, remember the between terminal is going to this resistance. With this arrangement, we can nullify the offset. So in some op-amps, that pin numbers 1 and 5 are not given. 1 and 5 are called as offset null pins. That won't be given in some op-amps. So you have to externally do some circuitry to make the output error voltage zero or output offset voltage zero. This is that circuitry. But I feel this is not needed for you. So you don't go into detail of studying this. Only for somebody who was interested, I mentioned this is another way. Okay. Okay. So here also we are showing inverting, non-inverting, and difference amplifier. The same three amplifier, but with additional circuitry to make the output offset voltage zero. Okay. Because it does not have the facility of offset null arrangement. If the offset null arrangement is given by the manufacturer of the op-amp, that is the best and easiest way to do it. Otherwise, you have to connect all this additional circuitry to make the output error zero. And please remember, I'm stressing this again, all that is needed only when you go for very high precision. When you want very high accuracy, only then you need to make all this. Not for our purposes. Okay. So with this, I'll move on to AC amplifiers. So just like I told you how op-amp based amplifiers will respond to DC input signals, they will surely respond to AC input signals also. So basically we have designed op-amp based circuits to work for AC only. We wanted to amplify AC signals efficiently. So what is the additional element we need to connect when we are working with AC input signals? We need to use coupling capacitors. So we will add coupling capacitors in the circuit. As you can see here, I have shown a simple op-amp based inverting amplifier. So in this op-amp based inverting amplifier, this offset null arrangement is there. I told you this is optional for you in the exam. Though he has given it in the textbook, you may or may not write it. It doesn't matter even if you don't write this offset null arrangement. Is it okay? So if you remember, you write. If not, you just show the power supply. You just write the rest of the inverting amplifier circuit. And the additional element, as I was telling you, is this capacitor. You can see capacitor CI is connected between the input signal and the op-amp inverting terminal, or and this resistor R1 which goes to the inverting terminal. So why do we need capacitors when we use AC signals? What's the need for capacitors with AC signals? See, whenever we use AC signals, we want complete isolation between the one part of the circuit and another. I don't want the DC conditions of this op-amp affecting the signal generator, or the DC voltage in the signal generator affecting the op-amp. So we want DC not to be added or amplified, because op-amp can amplify both DC and AC, correct? But I want this op-amp to be working just like an AC amplifier alone, not DC. We don't want it to amplify the DC signal. So what I'll do, I'll use this capacitor as an isolation device, separating the input from the rest, input signal generator from the rest of the circuit. And very often what happens is, it need not be just a signal generator. We may cascade two amplifier stages. We may be connecting one amplifier stage output as input to the second amplifier stage circuit. These pin numbers are mentioned for a different manufacturer. Don't worry about the pin numbers. Yeah, even I noticed 45369 is for a different op-amp. Actually, it should be 714, not 741. It's a 714 op-amp. Okay, then I was telling you this CI, why it is needed? To separate the DC conditions of the previous stage with the current stage, or with the current stage and the next stage. And why it should separate? Because op-amp is designed to amplify both DC and AC. If you wanted to amplify only AC, you should use a capacitor to separate the DC. So what is the job of this capacitor? It will hold the DC condition of the signal generator from reaching the op amp. It won't allow the DC level of the signal generator to reach the op amp, or the DC level of the op amp to spoil the signal generator. Either way, it will block DC. So a simple capacitor which can block DC is included whenever op amp should be acting like an AC amplifier. So what's an AC amplifier? It's a circuit which will amplify AC input signals and generate AC output signals. And what is the additional element to be included to amplify only AC? I need to include a capacitor at the input side. So remember, the input can either come from a signal generator or from another op amp. There can be a previous op amp circuit, and output of that may be acting like input to this circuit. So anyway, this is a simple inverting AC amplifier. We know the gain of this amplifier is minus RF by R1. Now, whenever we introduce a capacitive element, please remember it is frequency dependent. Capacitor is frequency sensitive or frequency dependent element. So what does it do? It decides the lower cutoff frequency. I hope if you remember when we studied frequency response of op amps, okay? When we studied this frequency response of op amps, we saw that the lower cutoff frequency will be limited by the coupling capacitors, the bypass capacitors. So here, Ci is an input coupling capacitance. So it will have an effect on the lower cutoff frequency of the amplifier, and it is simply decided by this equation. We'll not derive this equation here because in transistors it's derived completely. Here it is simply stated. We know any cutoff frequency is given by the equation 1 by 2 pi RC. So whatever is the cutoff frequency, lower or higher, it's decided as 1 by 2 pi RC. Here the lower cutoff frequency will be decided by this coupling capacitor Ci. So 1 by 2 pi into Ci, and the resistor which should be included is the series resistance which appears with this Ci. One resistance is RIF, where RIF represents the input resistance of this stage. What is the input resistance of an inverting amplifier? Do you remember what is the input resistance of an inverting amplifier? Yes? R1, right? You have derived it in the previous classes. The input resistance of an inverting amplifier is R1. So RIF here means the input impedance of the inverting amplifier, which is R1 in this case, plus R0. What is that R0? Suppose I have a signal generator, and that signal generator has some resistance, which we call it as R-sig, we used to call. R-sig or R-in it is called here. That value is also known as R-naught. Why they are calling it R-naught? For the simple reason that if instead of signal generator, I had used another op-amp stage here, the output resistance of this op-amp would be connected in series with this capacitor. So they are naming this resistance R-naught. So there are two resistors in series with this Ci. One is the signal generator resistance, R in or R sig.